Ascent TV is proud to present Muharram Lectures, presented by Sayyid Haydar Bahrul Uloom.
إلا بالله العلي العظيم. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. السلام عليك يا رسول الله. Salutations be upon you, O beloved Prophet Muhammad. Salutations be upon you, O Commander of the Faithful, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Salutations be upon you, O beloved Lady Zahra. Salutations be upon you, O beloved Imam Hassan. Salutations be upon you, O beloved Imam Hussein. As-salamu alayk, Sayyidi wa Mawlai, Ya Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Dear brothers and sisters, let us all go tonight to the land of Karbala, to that day in time called Ashura, the 10th day of the month of Muharram. It is called Ashura. It is the day where Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his entire family, companions, the woman and the children, they all entered the battle. Some of them were killed, some of them were martyred on the land of Karbala. Others, they say, dear brothers and sisters, after Imam Hussein alayhi salam was killed in the land of Karbala, the army of Yazid attacked the camp of Imam Hussein. Keep in mind, in the camp of Imam Hussein, there were children, there were women, there were no more warriors left, no more soldiers. But yet the camp of Yazid, who know no heart, no mercy, attacked the camp of Imam Hussein. Imagine the tents around, having all the women and the young children. What did the army of Yazid do? They say they came attacking, torching the fire, lighting the fire in the tents, and they came after the women and the children, scaring them. The woman and the children started running in the desert, calling, Wa Husayna, Wa Aliya, one woman would call out for her dying and killed son. One would call for her a killed brother. The other would call for Imam Hussein, having and calling to be aided. No one was being aided. No one was getting no aid because they were all killed in the battlefield of Karbala. Dear brothers and sisters, there was this woman amongst the rest. It was Lady Zainab alayha salam. She was gathering the woman. She was trying to secure the children. Anyone running from the soldiers of Yazid. Lady Zainab, she was like a woman with her heart spread between and amongst all the women and the children, carrying them, bringing them. They say there was a young daughter of Imam Hussein. This man from the soldiers of Ibn Ziyad, when he saw her, she was so terrified. She was a young girl. She was terrified. She was taken by the awe of the fire, by the attack of the soldiers. She looked at the soldier as he looked down on her. He asked her. He looked at her. She looked back. He said, "Where are you going? Young girl, where are you going?" She said, "What will you do to me?" He said, "Don't worry, I am not here to kill you." She said, "Would you then help me do something?" He said, "What is it you want?" She said, "Can you please point me towards Najaf?" He said, "Why do you want to know where Najaf is?" She said, "I know my grandfather Ali is buried there. I want to talk to him. I want to tell him, Jaddah, Aliyah, come and see what they did to our father Hussein. Come and see what they did to the women and the children. Wa Husayna ya ghareeb Hussein, mazloom Hussein, shaheed Hussein, everyone together, ghareeb, ghareeb Hussein, mazloom Hussein, shaheed Hussein. Ya laytana kunna ma'akum sa'adati, fanafuz fawzan azima. Salawat.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ثم الصلاة والسلام على النبي الهاشمي المدني الأبطحي التهامي السيد البهي السراج المضيء الكوكب الدري صاحب الوقار والسكينة المدفون بالمدينة العبد المؤيد الرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجد محبوب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We start tonight, inshallah, with a recitation from the holy book, from the glorious words of Allah Azza wa Jal, من القرآن الكريم, from Surah Al-Isra, verse 53. Allah Azza wa Jal says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُوا الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يقول التي هي أحسن إن الشيطان يزغ بينهم إن الشيطان كان للإنسان عدوا إن الشيطان كان للإنسان عدوا الشيطان كان للإنسان عدوا مبينا صدق الله العلي العظيم
صلوات Dear brothers and sisters, when we read the verses from the Holy Quran, we ought to learn the meanings of the words. Why? Because the only way you and I can truly benefit and help ourselves grow and help ourselves learn and help ourselves become something in this life. Most of us, as we grow, we are trying to find out what is it and what purpose are we fulfilling in this world? What are we doing? What are we aiming to do? What is our objective? What are we trying to achieve in this life? And these are all good questions you ought to ask, and don't ignore them. Once you start ignoring these questions and just becoming busy with your daily tasks and your day-to-day things and not really paying attention to these important and very valuable and most important objectives in your life, what happens to you? You end up not really focusing on these important issues. Time passes by, and what ends up happening? You find yourself at a point in time where you think it's too late to do anything. Most people, when you ask them about changing themselves, about being something different, about being someone better than what they are, they tell you, you know what, it's too late for me to change. They say, it's too late for me to be anything different than what I am. Why? Because they got used to a lifestyle. They got used to being someone who they are, that now if they want to change anything, they say, it's too hard for me to change. It requires this willpower to say, I will change. This willpower to say, I will not be what I was yesterday, but I will be someone better today and even better tomorrow. It's about change. It's about being different. It's about improving on yourself. How many of us truly think and making an objective in their life that they improve on themselves every single day. Because if you don't, I want you to know one thing. If it's not part of your core objectives in life to improve daily on who you are, then you're missing a big chunk of what it means to be a true religious person, to be a true Muslim. Religious people usually are given the title religious. Why? People don't realize, they see a person is, for example, praying, a person who's following some of the rules, they say, well, he's religious. Unfortunately, nowadays, when a person does the minimum requirements, he or she is called what? Look, they're religious. And sometimes the word religious is comes side by side with our with some negative attributes, unfortunately. Why? Because people don't realize what they're saying is wrong when they say, look man, he's asking us to pray, he's telling us to fast, that's too religious, it's too restrictive. See, they put this negative connotation to it, it's too restrictive. What do you mean I cannot listen to music? What do you mean I cannot dress as I wish? What do you mean I cannot go out whenever I want to, staying out at night, doing whatever I want to, going to places that are inappropriate to go? Why? They tell, for example, you find some people when they want to go out some at night, late at night, to certain places, God forbid, you know they're forbidden and they're not good, they will tell you, don't ask him, he is too religious, or don't ask her, she is religious. Why? Because they see that religious being restrictive, meaning that it tells you not to do things and allows you to do certain things. But they only focus on the things that are not allowed to be done, the things that are prohibited. And by the way, the things in Islam that are prohibited are very few. Everything is allowed unless there is a text or there is a command telling you it is not allowed. And you'll find there are very few things that are not allowed. Not many things. But we always focus on the negatives. We don't focus on how Allah Azza wa Jal, God Almighty, is telling you not to do things for a certain reason. He's telling you not to do them so you can shape yourself and become a better person. See, in Islam, when you look at what Allah Azza wa Jal has given us in orders and in laws, they came to address four issues. How to regulate your relationship with your own self. How to regulate your relationship with Allah. How to regulate your relationship with the rest of the people. And how to regulate your relationship with everything else in the universe. Four areas. Let me repeat them. First, Allah, through the teachings of the Holy Quran and Ahlul Bayt salamullahi ta'ala alayhim, what is He trying to teach us? What is the purpose of these teachings? Number one, to teach us the proper way to deal with our own selves. How to deal with our own selves. How to handle the I in me. Each and every one of you handles themselves differently. God has a certain way He wants you to handle yourself. So dealing with what? Yourself, number one. Number two, dealing with Him, with Allah. How should your relationship be with Allah the Almighty? That's the second step. After you know how to deal with yourself, the second level is how to deal with Allah. The third level is how to deal with other people around you. Because we all live amongst families, we all live amongst neighbors, we all live amongst community members. And we are part of the community member. And you and I have to be a very useful, very effective part of that community member. Now, this is how to deal with other people, is also something that Allah Azza wa Jal addresses and teaches us in every single detail of how to become an active and very useful member of the community. The fourth level is how to deal with everything else. How to deal with the environment, for example. How to deal with the plants, how to deal with open land, how to deal with anything that comes with the animals, how to deal with them, how to take care of them, how to take care of your environment around you, how to your responsibility. Now, when we talk about this, we have to realize that Allah Azza wa Jal says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. There is a purpose why we send with the prophets all these books and all these teachings. Why? So ليقوم الناس بالقسط, so mankind can observe that justice that they are required to achieve. Having said that, look at the requirement. Now we have addressed, there are four areas. Allah Azza wa Jal, the Holy Quran, and the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam came to address what? These four areas. Now, you see that in any act, anything you do in this life, need to fit one of these areas. If even the way you talk to yourself, the way you deal with yourself, is category number one. The way you talk to Allah, category number two. The way you deal with the rest of the people around you, category number three. The way you deal with everything else besides the humanity is category number four. Allah Azza wa Jal addresses every single bit of it. Now, the choice is yours. You have the choice to do what? To either follow it, then what would happen? If I follow God's teachings, then I will achieve a better person. I will become a better person. I as a person will be so much better. I will improve on myself. I will be useful to everyone around me. And mainly I will be useful to myself. But if I don't, I will be an illness to society. I will become part of that cancer in society. And cancer, when it starts spreading in the body, it eats the body, it kills it away. You are either an active part of healing the society, of healing the community, or an active part of being a cancer to the community. So the choice is yours. Imagine yourself, you either choose to be a cancer or a medicine. You either become a reason for the community to advance or for a reason for the community to come down. The choice is yours. I am not in the position to enforce anything on you. I am not in the position, even your parents, even your guardians, even your brothers and sisters, your friends, all they can do is try to convince you. At the end of the day, one day you'll grow up to be independent and on your own. And you will have to make your own decisions. But your decisions are either shaped and framed by the teachings of the Quran and Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, or they are framed by what you like, your desires, not regulated. One thing we ought to know, when we ask ourselves, why is it sometimes, see, the importance of these teachings is comes with understanding religion. I cannot understand these teachings to better myself, to be a more useful person, whether I'm at school, whether I'm in my family, unless I understand my religion. Now, some might ask you, Tayyib, what does it mean to be religious? To be religious, by the way, is very simple. Pay close attention. To be religious is not just to fast or to pray. To be religious is not just to put the scarf on and the head cover on. To be religious is not just to come and commemorate events such as this. To be religious is something that starts very deeply within. Very, very deeply within. Because some of us, yes, they might talk the talk, but do they walk the walk? They might say, I want to do this, I believe this, but you need to see what is it they do. Being religious is very simple. See the four things that I mentioned? The four relationships with yourself, with God, with the people, and with everything else. To be religious is to follow the teachings of Allah and discipline yourself. Discipline. So discipline yourself, so what? So you can be effective in applying all the rules for these four parts. That's being religious. Now, when you become religious, when you try to follow religion, it's very simple. Each and every person has rights and obligations. Let me explain this for a little bit. And today I want to focus on our relationships amongst each other. My relationship with other people. Your relationship with other people. Let's address this and be concise and try to benefit from the teachings of Allah Azza wa Jalla through Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. When I say you and I are neighbors, what does that mean? Let's say we're neighbors, we live by each other. It means I have rights on you and also I have obligations. Meaning what? Meaning when I do something, there are some things expected of me and at the same time there are some things expected of you. Okay? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, through Ahlul Bayt, He taught us something very important. He says, yes, there are rights that I have over all of you. God has rights all over all of us, but at the same time, there are rights that you have amongst yourselves. And you should deal with these rights because God can forgive. God is able to forgive. And God is the all-forgiving, all-merciful. But if you were backbiting someone else, if you and someone else were sitting down and you backbit a third person, God will forgive you given one thing. If let's say one day, La Samahallah, you did not pray, would God forgive you? If you repented and you came and begged Allah and asked Him to forgive you, He can forgive you, yes. Allah can forgive you if you truly repent and start doing the act of prayers. But let's say you are backbiting. Would Allah forgive you for backbiting? He says, I would forgive you. But first, you need to do something. You need to be forgiven by the person who you were backbiting. Now, this is the problem. We were fine until we got to this point. I can repent. I can seek forgiveness, but now I have to go and seek forgiveness from the person that I was doing what? Backbiting him or her. Why? Because this teaches us, dear brothers and sisters, that when we backbite and when we commit a sin, and a sin is not only what is haram, a sin can be something that is not useful for the human being. A sin can be anything that is not beneficial. Allah is saying, when we sin, when we commit this wrongdoing, what are we doing in return is harming someone. Yes, I'm backbiting. You might say, I'm just talking behind his or her back. Allah is saying, but that backbiting has a certain harm on the person that the only way he will and she will recover from that hurt is when you go and seek their forgiveness. Now, having said that, Allah Azza wa Jalla, let's go to the verse that we started reciting in the beginning. وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي, and tell my servants, يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ, to speak that which is kindlier. Look at what you say and say the most kind thing, the most kind speech to others. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Look what Allah says. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ. Surely the devil, يَنْزَغُ. يَنْزَغُ is when you take something you planted for the wrong reason, for the purpose of creating discord amongst people. Hatred. When a shaitan, it tries always to see any two people, how can a shaitan thinks to himself, how can I make them hate each other? How can I make them enemies to each other? What you in return, Allah is telling you, أَيَّقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ, to look and say what is best and most kind to one another. Why? Inna shaytana, because a shaytan, devil, kana lil insani aduwan mubina, was surely an open enemy to you. A shaytan, it tries to see any two people. There's harmony. A husband and a wife. A father and a son. A mother and a daughter. A brother and a sister. A friend and another friend. If they're doing something good, he tries to come in between and tempt one another against one another. Listen to this very carefully. A shaytan, whenever he sees harmony and peace amongst any two people, he needs to come as the third to make them enemies of each other. So Allah says, emphasizes on us to teach ourselves to be kind to one another. Sometimes you see how some fights get erupted. Some fights in high school, in college, in the universities, in houses, amongst people. You don't know why. You don't know what's happening. Why the original... I've told you sometimes, I know people who have not talked to each other for over 20 years. A brother and a brother. Why? You go down to it, you try to find out why. It's for really a ridiculous reason. A complete... Sometimes they don't even know why. Why did that happen? Because they allowed the shaitan to come in between them. See, we need to know our rights. We need to know our rights on each other and how we should deal with each other. And we need to be very, very careful, dear brothers and sisters. Look at Imam Ali alayhi salam is the greatest example after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He gives us so many great examples of how we should be, of how should we act, how should we grow. His brother comes to him, Aqil. His brother Aqil was old. He could not see very well, and he had a lot of children. In addition to all of that, Aqil was extremely poor. Aqil goes to Imam Ali. He tells him, brother, I need you to help me. You know, Imam Ali, at the point, he was the governor and the Khalifa over all the Muslim land. He was always the Imam. But at a certain point, he took the governorship, and he was under his authority, was the money of all the Muslims. Aqil, his brother, comes to him. He tells him, I am poor. I need help. Why don't you give me some of the money? Loan me, lend me, give me. Do me a favor. Look, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he's dealing with his brother. Imam Ali is entrusted by the wealth of the Muslims. Imam Ali is entrusted by the money of all the Muslims. And here he comes, his brother. He tells him to give some money, to give him something. Al-Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayh, look at his words. And I quote from Nahj al-Balagha. Wallahi la an abita ala hasaki sa'dani musahada. What does that mean? He tells Aqil, by Allah, I would rather pass the night or sleep the night in wakefulness, musahada, wakefulness, on the thorns of the sa'dan. What is the sa'dan? Sa'dan is a plant that has prickles on its ends. You can't, it would hurt you to even touch. Imam Ali, he says, I would rather sleep on this hurtful plant that would keep me awake, أو أجر في الأغلال مصفدة, rather than to be driven in chains as a prisoner to meet Allah. أحب إلي من أن ألقى الله ورسوله. All of this is more likely for me than to meet Allah and His Prophet يوم القيامة, on the Day of Judgment. Listen to this word, ظالما لبعض العباد. ظَالِمًا لِبَعْضٍ, an oppressor over any person. وَغَاصِبًا لِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْحِطَامِ, or taking over wrongly any of these leftovers, مِنَ الْحُطَامِ, حُطَامِ الدُّنْيَا, these things that are worldly wealth. شوف, الإمام tells you, I would rather be sleeping in that hurtful state, number one, or to be chained and taken as a prisoner, number two, rather than what? To oppress one person. To oppress one person. Oppressing a person, how could I oppress a person when I do him or do her wrong? Dear brothers and sisters, being religious means being kind to your relatives, to be kind to other members of humanity, to be caring, to take care to the utmost level that you do not hurt anyone and to make sure you do not oppress anyone. Do you listen to this word? Do not oppress. And you start by not oppressing yourself. So many of us become so busy in our daily lives, we care about nothing. The only thing we care is about ourselves. And this is wrong. Al-Imam Salamullahi Ta'ala Alayh teaches us. And listen, look how he tells his people, Al-Imam. والله لقد رأيت عقيلا وقد أملق حتى استماحني. He says, I saw عقيل, look, I saw عقيل until he is so poor and he's asking me from your money, people. And I looked at his children and they were شعث الشعور غبر الألوان من فقرهم كأنما اسودت وجوههم بالعظلم وعاودني مؤكدا. And look, he describes the children of عقيل, they're begging because they're so poor, they're so needy. And عقيل kept on asking Imam Ali, begging him to give him some money. فَظَنَّ Listen. فَأَصْغَيْتُ إِلَيْهِ سَمْعِي I lend him my ear to listen to him. فَظَنَّ أَنِّي أَبِيعُهُ دِينِي He thought, عقيل, for a second that I might sell him my religion. وَأَتَّبِعُ قِيَادَهُ And I follow his leader. مُفَارِقًا طَرِيقِي Look what Imam Ali a.s. did to Aqil. Aqil is old. Aqil is needy. But Aqil came to Imam Ali to ask him to give him some money, pass some money. فَأَحْمَيْتُ لَهُ حَدِيدًا He heated an iron piece of rod. Imam Ali heated this iron piece of rod. ثُمَّ أَدْنَيْتُهَا مِنْ جِسْمِهِ And I brought it close to his body. لِيَعْتَبِرَ بِهَا So he can learn from it. As he brought it closer to the body, Imam Ali says, عَقِيل felt the heat. فَضَجَّ ضَجِيجَ ذِي دَنَفٍ مِنْ أَلَمِهَا وَكَادَ أَن يَحْتَرِقَ مِنْ مَيْسَمِهَا That he cried as a person in protracted illness, cries with pain, and he was about to get burnt with its branding. يعني عقيل was just the heat, got him so scared and got him so woed. What is going on? Imam Ali عليه السلام said, ثكلتك الثواكل يا عقيل عقيل أتئن من حديدة أحماها إنسانها للعبه Oh, Aqil, do you cry from this piece of heated iron which has been made by man just for fun? وَتَجُرُّنِي إِلَىٰ نَارٍ سَجَرَهَا جَبَّارُهَا لِغَضَبِهِ And you take me towards and drive me towards a fire which Allah the Powerful has prepared for His wrath? No. Imam Ali is telling us, How could we fall victims just to please people? When you listen to someone backbiting, why do you listen to him or her? Why? Some Allah, you know, I don't want to cut her off. I don't want to cut him off. When you hang around people, men or women, when you sometimes, some people, la samahallah, God forbid, would fall to the temptations and go to the bar. Why? It's because they have not learned to say the word no. Learn how to say no. Learn how to say no to say, I will not share with you and oppress myself with you here. Learn how to say no, because when you say no, you're helping your friend wake up for what they're doing. For what they're doing is wrong. You awaken them, they realize it, and they stop. We need to realize there is a heated piece of rod anytime can come and take us. And you know what? It is not about the fire of hell. It is about pleasing Allah who created us. It's about being good people. Forget about heaven, forget about hell. But remember the mercy of Allah. Remember what He has given you and be grateful. And return that. See, Rasul al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, one day his companions came around and they were sitting with him. And they were talking about this lady, how religious she is. Look at the word, how religious she is. Are you listening? How religious she is. They told him how great her prayers are, how many days she fasts, how many hours she reads the Quran. Al-Rasul al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam put all that on the side and he asked one question. Listen to this question. كيف هي مع جيرانها? How is she with her neighbors? Listen to this. She is praying. She is fasting. She is reading the Quran. She's doing all these great things. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, put all of that on the side. Put all of that on the side. He asks, how is she with her neighbors? They told him, well, she kind of is harsh and uses foul language. Uses foul language and she is hard. He says, لا حاجة لله في صلاتها ولا صومها. God does not need her prayers or her fasting. Meaning what? Meaning a true religion. And to be truly religious is not only in your fasting and your prayers. I'm not telling you don't pray and fast. These are requirements. But the purpose of fasting and prayers is to be good and deal well with people. إِنَّمَا الدِّينُ الْمُعَامَلَةِ Religion is how you deal with each other. How you are kind to one another. How you worry about one another. How you really care about one another. Dear brothers and sisters, we need first and foremost to respect one another. This is so important. When you respect the individual, by first respecting yourself, awaken the respect in you, and that only happens when you realize yourself. When you realize who you are and what you are, you become more aware of it. You start being respectful to yourself. You realize the beauty and the taste of respect to yourself, you start giving it to others. If I cannot do something to myself, how can I give it to others? If I don't realize it myself, how can I give it to others? Now, dear brothers and sisters, one of the worst ways you can start destroying the relationship with others is through your tongue. طعن اللسان أمضى من طعن السنان. الطعن is to stab. Pay attention to this picture. Very important picture. الطعن is when someone stabs someone. الإمام سلام الله تعالى عليه, the commander of the faithful, says, طعن اللسان, the stabbing of the tongue, أمضى, goes deeper than the stabbing of the sword. When someone starts talking ill of someone else, just look at and imagine a sword going into his body. Would you ever kill someone by putting a sword through them? You'll say, of course not. We're not violent. We don't use force. We're not such people. Then watch for the sword that comes from your mouth called the tongue. Watch how you and what you do with your tongue. Some of us don't realize it. Al-Muslimu Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam defines a Muslim. I want you all to pay close attention to this. If you really acquire this and take it with you, we accomplish so much of our tasks. Who is a Muslim? المسلم من سلم الناس من لسانه ويده. The true Muslim is the one who people were safeguarded by what? From his tongue and his hand. يعني he does not hurt people with his words or her words, and she or he does not hurt people with their hands. But keep in mind, look how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what hurts most? Now if someone stands and starts talking to you and says bad words, bad things about you, does it hurt physically as much as someone beating you up? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says what? The stabbing of the tongue and to be safeguarded by the tongue is more important than what? Than the hands. Why? Because in reality, the tongue hurts more and damages more. With this, as simple as you might find it, as most important as it is. How many of us really were hurt and lost friendships just because of the tongue? Either they were spoken to wrongly or they said themselves something wrong. Dear brothers and sisters, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so kind and was so caring to everyone around him. To a point it was amazing. He cared about everyone's feelings. Do you believe? And let's learn from him. Let me give you a story of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Learn from him. Learn how he cared and he went so far out because he cared. One day he was praying. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was praying a group prayer, and the companions noticed the Prophet did the prayers a little bit faster than usual, than normal. Now, when he ended the prayers, the companions asked him, "Oh Prophet, is there anything wrong? We felt that you made the prayers was a little bit faster than usual." Listen to what he said. He said, "I heard the crying of a baby in the mosque. And I wanted to make sure I finish earlier." Why? Obviously for his father or his guardian to go and take care of him. Just because he heard a cry of a baby. Look the care this man, this prophet, this great individual, the best of all that walked on earth, the best of all creatures, Ar-Rasul A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our prophet, our role model, what he had in care. Each and every one of you, seriously now you should test yourself. How much care do you have towards one another? That you think twice before you speak so you don't hurt anyone. Because as I said, dealing with one another, إِنَّمَا الدِّينُ الْمُعَامَلَةِ. To be religious is not about your prayers only. It's not about your fasting only. It's not about your hijab only. It's not only about how many times you wrap something called Ya Hussein and you put it on you only. Deen, religion, is how you deal with one another. How you at school deal with one another. How much you care for one another in your family. How much you care about your parents. How much the parents care about the children. How much the brothers care about the sisters. That is true religion. So don't only when the night of power comes, you try to pray 100 rak'at and stay up all night and think you got stamped and achieved to be religious. No. It all could mean nothing and become useless. If when you're done with your prayers, when you're done with your fasting, when you're done with your recitation, when your father or mother say something to you, you frown back to them. All of it falls down. All your blessings, everything you've done, everything you've done become meaningless just when you frown back to your parents. Do you know how much disrespect that is in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal? Subhanallah. Yet we don't only frown, we do so many different things. Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teach us we should take high attention, pay high attention to these things. Why? Because when you pay attention to these little things in your life, believe me, they start shaping how you think and how you are. And dear brothers and sisters, we need to stand by each other, care for each other. We cannot only talk about one another. Why do we always try to put each other down when we need to help each other to become better? We need to look at each other's benefit. And amongst those that we were taught by, Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam and his family members. When we look at Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his family members, we see so much was given to them, by them. They have given so much so we can learn. Muslim ibn Aqil, one of the children of Aqil. He is the cousin of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Muslim ibn Aqil would do anything and give up anything for his master Imam Hussein alayhi salam. It's amazing the love Muslim had to Imam Hussein. Why? Because he respected him as a leader. Muslim was, when Imam Hussein alayhi salam started moving from Medina, the city of Medina, to go to Mecca, because Yazid, after asking Imam Hussein alayhi salam to pay allegiance to him, Yazid wanted Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein knew that he had to start leaving Medina and go to Mecca. In Mecca, as we know, Yazid sent assassins to kill Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein was receiving letters from the city of Kufa. What are the letters? They were telling him, "Oh Imam, come, and you have soldiers waiting for you." They say Imam Hussein received about 12,000 letters from people of Kufa. Now Imam Hussein wanted to see these people. How are they? What are they? So he dispatched to his cousin Muslim ibn Aqil. He gave him the order, the command, "O Muslim, go to Kufa and see and examine the people of Kufa. See how are they and what are they. Are they waiting for me? Are they ready for me? And send me the message." They say, Muslim ibn Aqil went ahead and entered the city of Kufa. When he entered the city of Kufa, at the beginning, so many people came, so many followers. They say at one point there were 18,000 people praying behind him in the mosque. 18,000. Now, at the same time, Yazid got hold of a Muslim, that Muslim came into the city of Kufa. Who was the governor of Kufa at that time? His name was An-Nu'man. And Nu'man was assigned by Yazid in Damascus to take care of Kufa. But when Muslim came in and so many people started gathering around Muslim, up to 18,000, all telling Muslim, "We are ready for Imam Hussein to come so we can fight with him," the spies, the ones that were spying for Yazid, sent to Yazid and told him, "And Nu'man, your governor, is not doing a good job. So send someone that could regain the power of Kufa, else you will have Kufa out of your hand." Yazid in Damascus, he called his advisor. His advisor called Sir John. He was very liked by Muawiyah and very close to Muawiyah. Yazid at that point asked Sir John, he told him, "What do you think? What should I do?" Sir John told Yazid, "Listen, if you want someone to save you at this point, call Ibn Ziyad." Ibn Ziyad was the governor of Yazid on Basra. This is a city that's to the southern of Iraq, close to the Arabian Gulf. He told him, go take Ibn Ziyad and make him a leader in Kufa, the governor in Kufa. But Yazid did not like Ibn Ziyad. Sirjan told him, your only way out is to tell Ibn Ziyad, ask him to take the governorship of Kufa besides Basra. Well, dear brothers and sisters, Ibn Ziyad came into Kufa. They say when Ibn Ziyad was trying to get to Kufa so fast that he dressed with a turban. He dressed as if he is how the Imam Hussein Islam would dress. But he hid his face. They say as he was coming in to the city of Kufa, he saw that everyone would call him, As-salamu alayka ibn Rasulillah, As-salamu alayka ibn Fatima al-Zahra, thinking that he was Imam Hussein. Because he was hiding his face, people did not know who he was until he entered the palace in Kufa. There and then, he ordered An-Nu'man to leave Kufa because he's taking the command over it. Now, Ibn Ziyad started looking around in the city of Kufa. What is happening? The spies came and told him, the situation is like this. Muslim ibn Aqil is gathering all the people around him. People are giving allegiance, are waiting for Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Muslim ibn Aqil was at that point in the house. He moved first from the house of Al-Mukhtar, a very important individual in Kufa, to another house, then to the house of Han ibn Urwa. Before that, there was a very prominent individual in Kufa that Ibn Ziyad wanted to go and visit. Look at this very, very important part. Ibn Ziyad wanted to go visit him because that man was sick. And he did not come and see Ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad knew that this man is influential. Knowing that Ibn Ziyad is coming to visit him, Muslim and this man, this man told Muslim, Ya Muslim, he is coming, Ibn Ziyad is coming to visit me. Why don't you hide behind the curtain? When Ibn Ziyad comes and sits, I will give you the signal and you kill him right there and then. And we get rid of Ibn Ziyad. By the time they were having this conversation, Ibn Ziyad enters, Muslim backs away and has to hide behind the curtain. They say Muslim was standing here, Ibn Ziyad was right under him. He could easily have killed him. Shuraik gives him, the individual gives him the sign to Muslim, go ahead, kill Ibn Ziyad, get rid of him. Nothing happens. The visitation comes and ends. He asks Muslim, why didn't you kill him? He tells him, I can't. This would be, if I do something like this, this is not a character of a Muslim. To stab someone without him knowing, without him fighting, without him knowing what is happening. And besides, why should I shed the blood in a house of like this? This is not appropriate, having this character. Muslim ibn Aqil then realizes it became dangerous in that house. He moves to the house of Han ibn Urwa. Now, Han ibn Urwa is one of the most influential people in Kufa. Ibn Ziyad, what he does, he says to, in order for him to break this movement, I need to take all the important people of Kufa and throw them in jail. And he started doing that in secret. He would go and into the house, takes the individual and throws him in jail. He did that for the top important people who Imam Hussein Islam was depending on. Amongst them was Han ibn Urwa. Han ibn Urwa, knowing that he was in the jail, they say Muslim ibn Aqil gathered the army of 4,000 and surrounded the palace. Dear brothers and sisters, they say when Muslim came, asked to release Han ibn Urwa. Now, Ibn Ziyad did something. He used the propaganda, the media. He started spreading the rumors that Yazid is coming with 70,000 to 100,000 soldiers and he will destroy all of Kufa. And he started buying people, telling them, if you come with me, I'll make sure I give you more money. I'll give you positions. I'll give you land. I'll give you this. I'll give you that. They say until the mother would come and take her child, the mother would come and take the son, the wife would come and convince the husband. They started thinning out the supporters of Muslim. They say until Muslim found himself with no one. They say, dear brothers and sisters, let us go to Muslim as he was leaving the mosque of Kufa. Dear brothers and sisters, Muslim, after having 18,000 people praying behind him, at that moment Muslim leaving the house of Allah, leaving the mosque of Kufa. Muslim was looking around. He needed someone to show him the way. Muslim had no one to show him the way until Muslim started going in the alleys of Kufa. Muslim realized that the people of Kufa turned against him. All Muslim wanted right now is to send a messenger to Imam Hussein and tell him not to come to Kufa. They say Muslim. The Muslim was in the dark of that night, going from one alley to another, until Muslim tried to relax a little bit. He stood by the house. He was so tired, he sat down in front of a house. The house was owned by a woman called Tawa. Tawa came out, looked at Muslim. He said, she told him, "Oh stranger, what are you doing here? Oh stranger, what I can do for you?" He said, "Ya Amat Allah, oh servant of Allah, I'm a stranger in this city. Oh stranger of Allah, I'm a stranger. Oh servant of Allah, I'm a stranger in this city. I have nowhere to go." She said, "What can I bring to you?" He said, "Any water will be good." She brought him some water, and he drank the water. She came back out. He is still sitting. She told him, "Stranger, I'm a woman here alone in the house. Why don't you go back to your house? Why are you sitting here out front?" He said, "Amat Allah, where am I to go? I have no house to hide in. I don't have no family. The family is coming from Mecca. The family of Imam Hussein alayhi salam." They say, a Muslim told Ta'a, "Wallah, wallah, my heart is with the family of Imam Hussein. My heart is with Imam Hussein. He's gonna come here to be faced with what? With people who are not going to be with him." They say, Ta'a, knowing who Muslim was, she said, "Tafaddal, come in." There was a separate part of her house made for the guests. Now Muslim stayed there all night. Ta'a had a son. Her son, his name is Bilal. Now Ta'a knows that she did not want to give the secret of Muslim being in the house. But her son saw that she was going in and out, checking on someone in the guest house. He told her, "Mother, who is this? What is going on?" She took promises from him not to say anything, and she told him, "Muslim ibn Aqil is in the house." Now Bilal knew that Muslim ibn Aqil, there was a reward for his head by Ibn Ziyad. He went early in the morning to Ibn Ziyad Ziyad and told him, Muslim is at the house. They say, Ibn Ziyad, send the soldiers to surround the house of Ta'a. Muslim ibn Aqil, hearing the horses coming around the house, they say, dear brothers and sisters, Muslim knew that his place was discovered and he was founded. He looked at Ta'a. He told her, servant of Allah, you fulfilled your task. May Allah grant you heaven for giving refuge to a member of the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Dear brothers and sisters, Muslim ibn Aqil, he comes out, he sees the house surrounded by so many soldiers. Dear brothers and sisters, Muslim ibn Aqil start fighting them one after the other. No one is able to hold down a Muslim. Muslim was so strong, they say, who would capture one person in his hand and throw him away? Muslim had so much power. Muslim was from the family of Ahlul Bayt. Dear brothers and sisters, they tried to capture Muslim, fight him. They could not fight Muslim. So what they did, they dug a hole in the ground and they started, and they covered it with something so Muslim cannot see it. And they started fighting Muslim towards that hole so he can fall in it, and then they could capture him. And that is what happened. They fought Muslim all the way until they pushed him to where the hole was. When Muslim fell in the hole, Muslim alayhi salam, realizing that he cannot fight any longer, they were able to jump on him, to capture him, take away the sword. Dear brothers and sisters, Muslim then was captured as a prisoner of war, taken to Ibn Ziyad. They say when Muslim was walking into the palace, captured with the soldiers around him, he saw some water and he wanted to drink the water. They say Muslim was so hurt when he tried to taste the water, parts of his mouth fell in the water. They say Muslim ibn Aqil, when he entered to Ibn Ziyad, Ibn Ziyad looked at him, and someone of the soldiers said, say the salams to the commander of the faithful. Muslim said, I shall not say any salams to any commander of the faithful that I don't see around here. Who you have is not a commander of no faithful. Dear brothers and sisters, Muslim ibn Aqil had an argument, went back and forth with Ibn Ziyad. They say Ibn Ziyad told Muslim, no matter what you say, you shall be killed. So don't worry about it. You're going to be killed. So if you have anything to say, anything, any will you want, just make sure you give your last will to someone. They say Muslim gave his last will to Umar ibn Sa'd. He was the only one around there that would accept Muslim talking to him. What was the will? What did he ask him? Would you please send someone to go and tell Imam Hussein of what happened in Kufa? Dear brothers and sisters, they say, then Muslim alayhi salam was taken to the roof of the palace of Ibn Ziyad. They say Muslim, before he was put to be beheaded, he looked towards Mecca outside of Kufa, and then they saw tears coming down from his eyes. The soldier who was about to kill him said, ya Muslim, someone like you, why is he shedding the tear? He said, Wallah, these tears are not for me. These tears are for Imam Hussein, who's bringing his children and the woman, not knowing what will happen in Kufa.
Imam Hussein alayhi salam, knowing the people of Kufa, knowing every bit of what happened in Karbala, but Muslim, his heart was with Imam Hussein. A Muslim called from far away, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah, As-salamu alayka ya Ibn Rasulillah, As-salamu alayk Sayyidi ya Hussein. Salutations upon you, O beloved Imam Hussein. They say Muslim then was beheaded and killed. What did they do with the body of Muslim? They took the body and they threw it from top of the castle to the ground. And then they tied the body and they dragged it along the aisle and the alleys of Kufa.
Dear brothers and sisters, look at the tyrants, what they did. Look at the tyrants, what they did to the body of Muslim.
Muslim, 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 all he cared for is the safety of Imam Hussein. Ya laytana kunna ma'akum sadati, فنفوز فوزا عظيما. إلهي بحق محمد وآل محمد.
Dear brothers and sisters, let us ask Allah for the sake of these nights, for the sake of Imam Hussein. Any one of you who has a need, who has a request, ask Allah Azza wa Jal for the sake of Imam Hussein. Insha'Allah, any need and request you have will be fulfilled.
Bika ya Allah, bika ya Allah, بك يا الله بمحمد 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 بعلي 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 بفاطمة 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 بفاطمة.
Everyone بالحسن
بالحسن بالحسن بالحسن.
In the loudest of your voices, dear brothers and sisters, let us direct ourselves and talk to Imam Hussein in Karbala.
بالحسين 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 بالحسين.
اللهم تقبل منا هذا القليل ونهدي ثواب ما قرأنا وثواب السورة الفاتحة لأرواح أموات جميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما الحاضرين منهم. نهدي لأرواح أمواتهم ثواب الفاتحة تسبقها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد ثلاثا بأعلى الأصوات.
Copy, duplication, distribution, and broadcast of this program is strictly prohibited by law without the express written consent of Ascent TV. All rights are reserved. to Ascent TV. For more programs like this, visit us online at www.ascenttv.net. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.